A lot of people actually, when they stop me, they're like, man, I used to watch your videos all the time. What are you up to?
I'm like, making videos.
You're listening to What a Joke
with Tom Papa and Fortune Feimster
on Netflix as a Joke Radio, Sirius XM Channel 93.
Welcome back to What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. I'm Tom Papa.
I'm Fortune Feimster.
We're very excited because our guest Hannah Hart is here.
Hello.
Hi, Hannah.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for having me.
So delightful this early morning.
I woke up and I was like, maybe I don't go.
we say that sometimes too.
It's sad to wake up when it's dark outside.
It's very sad.
So dark, and it keeps getting darker and darker.
The planet has a way of doing this every year. You know?
It's so painful.
We get a message all of a sudden. Hannah's not coming. It's dark outside.
She'll come when she can see. Hannah has a new book coming out called My Drunk Kitchen Holidays, which you can pre-order on Amazon right now. And it's all recipes about different holidays, but in your drunken cook style?
Yeah, no, it's really just in my writing style.
In just your writing style?
That seems drunk.
Call it what you want. No, so My Drunk Kitchen Holidays, How to Savor and Celebrate the Year, is really about a testament to how shitty some of the holidays are and how we can spend our whole years ramping up to what will be the inevitably regressive state you fall into in the holiday season.
Which is your worst holiday?
Probably, I'm going to say Christmas is the most guilt-inducing holiday. You know, one year we skipped Christmas and it was the best.
Really?
It was nice.
What makes it bad? Your family?
The pressure. It's all my own self-imposed expectations. Okay. You know what I mean? Plus, everyone always says to me, I'm the person the family has, what are we doing for Christmas?
Right.
And I'm like, huh? We?
Is there a lot of guilt in your family?
Oh, you know, just like the standard familial amount of guilt.
Do they want you to come to them on Christmas?
I think that they want me to decide what we do for Christmas.
Yeah, they're like, you're the big star.
Oh, you're in charge?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I'm in charge.
Moneybags over there. Hey, Moneybags, what are we doing for the holidays?
And you know, even when I wasn't Moneybags, they would ask me what we're doing for the holidays. I'm that person in the family.
Yeah.
How'd it go when you just said, we're not doing it this year?
Oh, well, a couple of years ago, my fiance, Ella, and I decided, I was like, you know what? Let's just spend Christmas, the two of us.
Yeah.
Fuck them. You know? Yeah. Let's get out of here,
man. Did you tell them that? Fuck you guys.
No, I didn't.
Merry Christmas.
Although, I will say the Hanukkah recipe opens with mazel mazel, motherfucker. You know what's so funny? They told me I could curse on the show, and they're like, you know, you don't really seem like someone that curses, and now it's apparently all I do.
Yeah, just flying out.
Left and right. Good morning. I'm sorry. No, it went over really well. They were like, okay.
Wow.
It was almost like, touche.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I didn't realize you realized you could do that. Like, you know?
And it was the best?
It was the best. But I don't love the holidays. Look, honestly, my dad was a Jehovah's Witness, so we didn't even celebrate birthdays.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, really?
They don't do the Santa Claus thing.
Mm-mm, Santa. No birthdays. The year I turned 10, double digits, not a word. Marry a peep.
No Halloween.
No.
Oh, that's the devil's
day. That's
the devil's day.
It's the devil's day.
But you weren't Jehovah?
Like, no, I live with my mom. But I would go to his house on weekends. And then sometimes it would be my
mom once gave a Jehovah's Witness a Santa Claus figurine for Christmas. She's, you know, a sweet old Southern lady.
Yeah.
She's like, here's a beautiful figurine of Santa Claus. And the lady could not have been more offended.
Oh my god. Well, also, honestly, like, as a queer person, like, or as a person that, you know, you don't see a lot of representation of yourself in the holidays, like,
right?
Because everyone's
where are those Target commercials?
Yeah, where's my Target commercial? Yeah. Or where's my dysfunctional family Target commercial? You know?
Yeah.
Where it's just like, I can't believe we're doing this again.
Right.
So I mainly wanted to write a holiday cookbook that just kind of was honest, you know, and open about how to make it through the holidays and how to spend your year finding causes for celebration.
Yeah.
There's a lot of weird holidays during the months of the year, I got to tell you.
Yeah.
Left-Handers Day.
That's not a real holiday.
That is.
Is that a holiday or a hashtag?
Holiday.
Because we've turned into like, you know, every day is a hashtag National Puppy Day. Yeah. And then the next day is hashtag National
Fingernail Day.
Dog Day.
If that's all it takes.
How did your whole...
Shebang?
How did it all start? You just were like, I'm going to start making videos?
I was 24. Mm-hmm. The year was 2011. I was living in New York as a proofreader at a translation firm. Uh-huh. You see, my original ambition was to become a translator. Uh-huh. 2008, 2009, when I graduated college, the market had crashed. And so by 2011, it was like any part-time, anything you could get vaguely related to your field was amazing.
Yeah.
Right.
And so when I moved from San Francisco, where I'm from, to New York, my best friend was... you know, left behind. And so basically I made the first video for her.
Oh,
you know, we
good.
Were literally G-chatting or like on Skype or something.
Right.
And she was like, man, I miss when you would like get drunk and cook, man. And I was like, dude, I'm gonna get drunk and cook for you right now. And I had a MacBook, a white MacBook my sister had gotten me because my old college Toshiba, you know, was just like my 8-pound, 12-pound Toshiba, probably more, where the battery's permanently dead, so you have to always have it plugged in.
Right. Yeah.
But then if the plug also is kind of broken, so sometimes it just shuts off, you know. So my sister got me a MacBook, and so I shot that video in Photo Booth and then put it into iMovie and then cut it up and sent it to her. And it was called Buddy Oh Shit. Because it was just a video to send to my friend.
Right. Yeah.
But it turns out the YouTube was a public space.
Oh, you put it on YouTube for her?
With no idea.
But I sent her the link.
Right.
Oh, I was funny. Like, here you go. Watch it. This is funny. You know?
Yeah.
And then all these strangers started commenting. I mean, you remember, this is 2011. The idea of a YouTube star didn't exist.
Right.
I was part of the generation that was fortunate enough to help pioneer that.
Right.
Right.
And so anyway, I saw it as like, it was just such an incredible opportunity to, I guess, have some vague work in entertainment.
Yeah.
Because, frankly, like, it's the scariest industry there is. And I never wanted to go after it.
Right.
I was never brave enough. I was never a theater kid. Like, I wasn't brave enough. I was too scared.
Mm-hmm.
So when I had total control via making videos, I loved it.
You just put out your own content.
That's amazing. And so it's kind of like crept up on you.
Yeah, I was worried it was going to permanently damage my resume and I'd never get a job again.
No more transcribing.
Well, I worked that whole year. That whole first year, I still was a part-time proofreader.
Right.
And I posted videos like once every 3 weeks.
Uh-huh.
Did it catch quickly? Like, was it big numbers right away?
Yeah, by 2011 standards, yeah.
Right.
And then I think the moment that was the most disorienting was when Time Magazine was like, we're doing an article about internet food shows.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay. And I had 6 videos on the internet, but somehow was one of the most popular internet cooking shows.
Wow.
That's how small the space was.
Wow.
Today, ain't nobody would've known.
Like,
right.
It wouldn't happen. There's
so
much food
content.
That's
crazy how fast that happened.
I feel so lucky.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And now I get to publish cookbooks that are funny, but then also deeply sentimental. Do you like laughing, but then also letting yourself cry just a little?
That's good.
Yeah. And well, now you have such a huge platform. Is there, you feel like there's a lot of, I don't know, a lot of young kids, a lot of people look up to you. It's like YouTube is their, I don't know what you would call it. There's
God.
Yeah,
God,
it's their main media,
Does that come with a lot of responsibility?
Well, I've always been really lucky because YouTube as a platform skews 13 to 17.
Okay.
Fortunately.
13 to 17.
Oh, yeah, man. It's young.
Wow.
Fortunately for me, I'm 18 to 35.
Oh,
so
okay.
Everyone who started watching me, like, oh, you helped me get through high school, you helped me get through college. They're all young adults now. A lot of people actually, when they stop me, they're like, man, I used to watch your videos all the time. What are you up to? And I'm like, you know, you could
make videos.
I make videos. Crazy garlic fries the other day.
How many videos have you made now? Do you know?
Over 600.
Wow.
Like 630. I could find the number, but
that's amazing.
Yeah, it's a whole catalog of work. So
that's amazing.
I think I'm going to slow down.
Yeah.
You're tired.
Yeah, I'm tired. And I'm also like, it's just one medium, right? Like,
right.
I don't know. It's not, I don't think it's necessarily like the YouTube is the space for someone like me anymore. You know?
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
What do you mean? Why?
Have you been on the internet lately?
You mean
no.
The very negative, the
honestly,
negative
no.
Space?
Yeah, well, me neither. So then yeah. We're on the same page.
It's a lot more work than people realize. My buddy was in 2009 or was trying to crank out YouTube videos because... And he was like, I can't keep up with this.
You know, and it's so wild, though, because it's like we built our own monster. It's like, who decided weekly? Who decided we had to post videos all the time?
Right.
You know? Right. But it honestly, the truth is, and I'm gonna blow your minds, there's not really money in YouTube.
Really?
Really? Even if you're one of those popular...
AdSense doesn't make you a lot of money.
Did it used to? Did it change? Or it never
it
really
used
did?
To. It used to make more. And yeah, yeah. It did change. But imagine... that your boss right. only pays you based on how well your coworkers are doing too. So
oh really?
That's... Well, because the AdSense goes up and down. You guys really want to learn about this?
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah.
I
yeah.
know it all, baby.
Yeah, I'd love
I
to.
Am the internet.
I don't really know how it works.
So when someone does something catastrophic or right. monstrous,
okay.
all and the advertisers back out of the space, your paycheck goes down.
Oh,
not because of your work, but because of the space. Because
oh,
it's all one big bed of money.
Gotcha.
Like, it's all just AdSense. It's all the advertising money. That's how it works, guys.
Wow.
So, do I love that? No.
Right.
Yeah.
You want to be paid based on your work.
Yeah, you know, which is why I think, like, I genuinely believe, you know, and this is clearly an entertainment and business podcast, right, guys?
Yeah,
it sure
absolutely.
Is.
I genuinely believe we're about to see a turn in entertainment that's more about direct-to-consumer niche content as opposed to put yourself out there
right
and make sure you try and get as many views as possible largest right. common denominator etc. I'm looking right. forward to a return to kind of more you know niche category content
right
you know because
right.
I just want to hang out with people I like
yeah
you know?
And do you think that'll be online
probably back gonna to the be network like model. Nanobots in our arms man yeah